So in that regard, the state budgets relied a little bit less on the upswing in coal than it would otherwise have relied upon, and it's also shared the benefits with workers' comp.
And one other question, Secretary Helton, I'll pose this to you, and this is probably a diversion of everything we've talked, because we've talked today a lot about the budget and primarily the energy segment of that budget and how important that is to state funding. But one other area that we've seen a lot of growth is in the gambling industry in West Virginia and the revenues associated with that. Where do you see that being in the future, and has that in any way helped or hurt keeping us kind of in a smooth pond in troubled waters?
It's a very good point. You know, if you go back to 1994 when the Racetrack Video Lottery Act was passed, or actually in the mid to late 80s when the citizens of West Virginia voted to allow a lottery. And so that lottery began, I guess it's about 22 years ago, 23 years ago. And that revenue started off very, very small. I think members of the legislature said if we could just get $1 million a year out of the lottery, we'd be happy. And you know, that part has grown and pretty much leveled off what we call the traditional lottery. The lawmakers in 94 passed the Racetrack Video Lottery Act and started off with a few hundred machines and a couple of the tracks. Now they're, I think, approaching 12,000 or more in those four tracks. And most recently, as you're aware, table games passed. Two of the tracks have actually had table games up and running for about a little less than a year now. And one other track has been up just a short period of time. The other track, Charlestown Races in the Eastern Panhandle, we'll actually have a referendum, we understand, this coming spring, and we'll decide, the voters in that county will decide whether or not they'll have table games. What we've actually seen happen with the lottery is the lottery fund itself, the regular traditional lottery, would produce about $170 million a year in revenue that was generally appropriated for seniors, education, and tourism, those areas there, and help supplement those budgets from what general revenue is done. With the growth in Racetrack Video Lottery and the others, the lottery the last couple of years and this year is on track to produce in excess of $600 million in profits, which is appropriated, you know, your promised scholarships, infrastructure, a number of, I won't go down the list entirely, but a number of great causes. They've been able to generate surpluses the last several years, which have been able to be used for, as has been indicated, one-time expenditures rather than building the base.
And last thing I want to talk about today maybe is something I mentioned early on, and that's kind of where the state's investments are, because that doesn't particularly affect you as much, Mark, but Mike, it does you a lot, because one of the things we have to do is fund the pension systems, and one of the things that we look at is the unfunded liability on those systems, and the actuary, Harry Mandel, who's not with us today, but he kind of does that long-range forecasting and tell us what we need to do. So when we see some loss in value in our portfolio, and knowing that that's going to come back, where do you see that this year and moving into the future? Because that will ultimately make it tougher on you to balance that budget.
Absolutely, it does. We met with the retirement systems actuary yesterday, got some preliminary numbers. The investments over the last year did lose some money, and what that does is takes money out of their trust funds, which is not money that's needed for day-to-day operation. We in the state do not rely on outside funding sources to fund our daily operations, so our cash flow in the state is very good, very healthy. However, in long-term budgets, when the stock market does go down, we try to fund our retirement systems at a flat level. And in previous years, we tried to reach a mark to where we said, okay, if we fund this amount every year, this is what it's going to take in order to keep those, to make those retirement systems to approach 100% funding level. The teacher's retirement system last year and the unfunded liability required $289 million to fund it. and that was to be flattened out. However, with the losses that have occurred in the stock market, it's going to require about another $38 million above that this year, or FY10. So that's $38 million that we're going to have to put in the retirement system that perhaps we could have used for something else. But overall, our retirement systems are growing tremendously, and the unfunded liability is coming down. The net assets are growing as a percent funded. So we're on our way, as long as the stocks can rebound, and I'm sure over the long term, you know, those well, numbers will yeah. come back.
And historically it has, and I think that's one thing that maybe the viewers, maybe some comfort to them of understanding that we actually are able to pay all of our pension benefits and obligations with dollars coming in the door today.
That is all on a daily, yeah. The cash for this year is there. We're not having to dip into any investments to pay our day-to-day paygo for the current years. Yeah. There's plenty of inflow yeah. cash to take care of the outflow cash.
In many pension systems, they have to sell assets every month in order right. to pay benefits mm-hmm. going out the door, and, exactly. and we're not in a position like that. Now, right. as our workforce continues to grow older and we have more and more people retire, at some point we'll be in that position, but right. fortunately during right. this downturn in the market,
exactly.
we're in a position where we're just putting money in and not having to take money right. out of the system.
Right. And that's why we're putting money in today to pay for those expenditures that we know will happen 15, 20 years down the road.
And so I think that it is important that we are really, you know, it's unusual when we sit here today and we're talking about West Virginia finances and state finances, and people that have lived in their state all their lives, as I have always known, it's sometimes been a rocky road for us.
Yes.
But we're sitting here where revenues are good, even though the market and our long-term investments have taken a hit, as they have, I'm sure, for the people watching today, if they look at their 401k statements today or their pension statements, are going to see some losses. We're all taking those losses because of the volatility of the market. However, we're not in a position where we're dependent on those dollars, and we can actually ride this storm out.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And hopefully we're going to see that come back and be where we still expect to be 20 years down the road. It's a perfect storm in many ways for an economic standpoint for this country, but we've kind of positioned ourselves in West Virginia in a very unique position. And I commend you gentlemen, as I do the governor, of helping steer us in the direction where we need to be. And if anything, I want the people watching this show to understand that times are tough, and times may get tougher in West Virginia,
yes.
but we are in a far better position today than we've been in a long, long time. And I just want to thank you gentlemen for sharing with us a few minutes and sharing with the people of West Virginia where we're at, and hopefully they'll have a better understanding when they see those headlines in the newspaper and they read those journals about the condition in West Virginia. They'll know that they'll understand the numbers behind that. And so I just thank you all for being with us and sharing with us today.